Hello and welcome to this Youth for Europe online talk. My name is Alfonso Diaz and I will be your host today. I was a participant in the Youth for Europe project last year in Spain. And for those of you who don't know the Youth for Europe project, it's a European Union funded project that aims to bring together European young people and policymakers so young people can have their voices heard on issues that matter to them, like jobs, the environment, media, or education. More than 100 young Europeans have participated in this project, and they've put great amounts of effort in producing the policy proposals that we're discussing in this series. In today's talk, we have a policy proposal on the topic of education. And to present this policy proposal, we have with us Denis from Hungary. He was a Youth for Europe participant. Hello, Denis, and thank you for being here. You're very welcome. Also with us on screen today, we have Uxia from Spain. She was also a participant in the Youth for Europe project. Welcome. And I also want to say hello and welcome to the audience that's watching on Facebook and to remind them that they can use the chat to drop questions and we will try our best to answer them at the end of the discussion. And now, and without further ado, let me introduce you our very special guest today. She's a member of the European Parliament for Spain. She sits in the group of the Progressive Alliance of Socialists and Democrats, and she's a member of the Committee on Employment and Social Affairs. Ms. Alicia Oms, thank you so much for being here. We're very happy to have you.
Thank you. I'm really happy to be here with you.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to all of us. Before we get started with Denis' proposal, Alicia, do you mind telling us a little bit about yourself, anything you'd like, and maybe about your experience in Parliament?
Well, as you know, I was elected in the last European elections last year in 2019. I'm the youngest of the Socialist and Democrats group, and I'm also the president of the Young European Socialists. So I'm really working a lot on youth policies from different aspects. I'm always trying to bring this youth perspective that sometimes people from other generations don't think that much about. And that's my priority in the parliament, to make the voice of the youngest be heard. I thought the employment committee was the best one to improve our policies, because we have a huge problem in the employment part. The youngest generations, we have really high rate of unemployment. Now that we are facing a new crisis, we will see it again, and we need to stop it. We saw it in the crisis of 2008. So I thought that the best way to help was being in that committee, and that's why I chose it. And I'm hopefully I will do my best to help our generation that cannot be again another youth generation lost. So let's all work together and try to do our best.
Thank you, Alicia, and congratulations on being the youngest in your group. It's such an accomplishment. It's funny because you could have participated in the Youth for Europe project as a participant, being so young, you know, but you're on the other side of the screen. That's quite an achievement. I wanted to ask you, if you don't mind, do you have any anecdotes that you want to share with us on your first days? I don't know, that kind of stuff that happens when you're like a young person coming into a place that's typically for older people, let's say. Do you have anything to share?
Well, yes, as you can imagine, many people thought that I was an assistant, and when I was, you know, in the parliament, we all bring this badge, this accreditation that, I mean, to open doors and get inside the places. And many times I had the problem that someone talked to me in a bit rude way, and when I showed the badge and they saw that I was an MEP, they changed and it was like, oh, sorry, we are not used to have that young people as MEPs, including we have a bar that is for MEPs for having meetings. And once I was going into the bar and they told me, sorry, you cannot be here because is for MEPs. And I was like, yes, but I'm an MEP, so I must be here. So at least I have many anecdotes like this. But I think that this mandate, we have more young people in our group, in the S&D. We are, some of them actually, we have made a group of under, we say it under 40, but we have people under 30 also. And I think it's really interesting also at the in our European Parliament in general, with other groups, we try to the youngest to get in touch and to work together. And I think that it's really important that in next mandates we could keep having more young MEPs, because our perspective is really necessary there inside.
And do you mind, Alicia, telling us a little bit of your journey? How did you manage to arrive to such a position so early in life?
So how can you repeat the question?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask you if you can tell us about what steps did you take before, maybe in politics or maybe not. How did you arrive to be a member of the European Parliament so young? What have you done before?
Yes, well, I in university I was studying. I'm a political scientist. I was focusing my studies in international relations. Actually, I did my master in diplomacy and foreign affairs. I was in the PSOE. I'm in the youth in the PSOE since I was 18. Since the very beginning when I started university. And before being in the European Parliament, I was in the cabinet of the Minister of Jobs, Industry and Trade in the Balearic Islands, in the government of the Balearic Islands, where I learned a lot. Also in the party, in the youth, we were working a lot. We were making many campaigns. Where you are inside the political organization, the work never stops. So in the end, my passion, my dream was also to be in the European Parliament. I was actually a trainee during my Erasmus. I did my Erasmus in Brussels, and I was trainee in the European Parliament from a member from the Balearic Islands. And when I was there, for me, it was like, wow, this is a dream for me. And now it's like, okay, this dream came true, and I'm putting all my efforts to do my best, and hopefully these 5 years, well, now four, because one has passed super quickly, I will learn a lot, and I will try to teach a lot also to the others.
I can imagine how amazing it must have felt when you came back as an MEP after being there as a trainee, right? Like the first day arriving there. Must have been amazing. Another question, Alicia, to the young people that are watching, we're all young here on the Zoom call and at the audience, and you are as well. I'm sure some people like politics and have passion like you did, but don't know where to start. If they're like, I want to get into politics, how do I start? Do you have anything you could say to them to inspire them?
Well, when you start in politics, what I did when I started, I was really conscious that the political party that I like it was the Socialist Party. So I went with my father to the to our building, and I went there to inscribe myself to the youth section and then to the party. But sometimes there's people that doesn't have really clear in which political party they would fix better. Sometimes it happens. But sometimes the best thing is to participate in the and follow them in all the media, because we always publish all the activities we do. So the best thing is follow the events and the things they are doing and see how is the work they are doing, which ideological line they are following, and which is the one that fits better with your own ideas and your own ideology. In my case, I have it really clear, and like, you know, when you are 18, I went with my father to the fielding and I inscribed myself. But it was quite funny because then later my parents were the ones inscribing themselves in the party also. It was like in the different way, because sometimes are the parents that push a little bit their sons and to do it. But in my case was on the opposite. So the idea is to do that, to try to follow the political groups that you think that are more close to your ideas are doing their activities, and see which one fits better with your ideas, and then participate in some activities. I mean, there is a lot of people that comes and leaves from the political parties and change from one to the others. We see it many times. And the point is that you find your place where you can express your ideas, and that you feel comfortable expressing your ideas.
Thank you, Alicia. Just before we move on to the proposal, because you mentioned that you are the president of the Young European Socialist now, right? If I'm correct. For those of us who don't know much about this, can you tell us a little bit of this organization and what you guys do?
Well, in this organization, we are the youth of the Socialist Party of every country. We have it's from the European territory. It's not just the European Union. We have also Switzerland, for example, or many others that are in the organization. And what we do is to try, we do activities regarding many topics, seminars, just to debate what's going on in our countries, how we can help our organizations in the other countries with campaigns. For example, if I don't know, in Spain we have whatever, so we receive the support from the others. We make many manifestos. We try to push for political steps that we want. Actually, a few weeks ago, we sent a letter to Ursula von der Leyen, to the president, to the commission, regarding the students, regarding the digital problem that they have, that they had during this pandemic. And we received the answer of the commissioner in this case, Margaritis Espinas. And that's our work, mainly to also do this comparative politics, see how every country works. And I think it's really useful, because sometimes you get really good ideas from what's going on in one country that you can use it in another and improve also not just your organization, but also the proposals that you can do to the country in a youth perspective.
Thank you, Alicia. We're going to move on now to our policy proposal today, so we have enough time to discuss it. So Dinesh today is going to present us his group's policy proposal, which is called Iki Seeds. So Dinesh, whenever you're ready, the floor is all yours.
I hope you can see the screen. Okay. First of all, I would like to say thank you for having the possibility to introduce our proposal to you. The members of our group are Tanya and Ushia from Spain, Milena from Germany, and myself. And our topic is the problems of the school education and the need of non-formal education methods in the most part of Europe. Just give a short summary of our idea. We believe that the traditional school system can't help the children and the young students to improve their passions and find their true personality. And especially in my country, in Hungary. This is the case because there is so much pressure on students and even on primary school students to have good grades, for example, and now that is why they can't find they can't find the true passions or activities which they would improve. Yes, and they have to learn so much stuff which are very, very useful, useless in the life and in the labor market as well. And for that, practical and creative activities have a very low percentage in comparison with the other school's subjects, and we have heard that this is the case in most parts of EU countries, and that is the main point of our proposal, creating a European-wide youth center network in which all students, all youngsters could find the activities and the practical pastime doings which they can use to improve themselves. We think that these new youth centers should focus mostly on the rural parts of the member states, because in these regions children have much less opportunity than in cities, and as we know that there are already some youth centers in some European cities, propose that these youth centers, already existing institutions, should be helped financially, for example, to expand their activity and reach more and more regions and more children and youngsters. Our basic idea is that these youth centers would not exchange the traditional school education, but it would complement it or supplement it, so students could spend their time in these institutions in the afternoon after school, and of course it would be not obligatory for anyone, they could choose from diverse activities and creative pastime activities. And also they could suggest what they would like to do. We think that this new model of youth centers should be financed by the EU, and these institutions could hire enthusiastic teachers or youth workers, volunteers, or perhaps some institutions could organize some activities for students. So it will be very inclusive, and the essence of or the main goal of that proposal is that creating an active participation of the students in practical and creative activities. And we believe that with this accomplishment, they would be much more involved in the social life of the communities, for example, in a city or in the country. Yes, and finally, let me say some words about why we chose this name, Icky Seeds. The word Icky describes the Japanese philosophy, Ikigai, which is shown in this picture. I hope that you can see that. Yes, and it means that we should find our passion, our mission, our vocation, and our profession. Sorry, at the same time, and this is the main point of that. And the word seed represent the huge potential which every person has, and we think that with the help of these youth centers, almost every person or much more person, young person, could find their passions and true personality in the right time, not when they are adults or I don't know, but in the right time, and with that we think that they could be a much more valuable member of the society, and they will be much more skilled at the one hand, and their life quality will be also better, and if the life quality of ordinary people is better, this means that that the quality of the society is also improving. So yes, I think that's all. I'm looking forward to your reflection. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dennis, for that presentation. And now, Alicia, if you wish, it's your turn to give some feedback, comments on the presentation you just saw. Thanks.
Yes, well, first of all, I think, and I have to congratulate you, because I think it is an interesting project, and it focuses on a very important part of the education, that is the informal education. I really like that you have introduced the Ikigai concept to describe the spirit of the program for youngsters to develop the important things in life, meaning, profession, passion, and vocation. I think this phase from one of the authors of the video summarized very well your goals, that it says we don't need a system where people are followers, but a system that follows people's needs. And I think that is really, really necessary to keep this in mind. I agree with you in the importance we should put on the informal education. We learned a lot in our leisure time, and many times we discovered our passion there. I mean, in my case, it was this. I mean, I was spending my free time going with the youth of my political party, and I found my passion there. So, and people that like, for example, arts, that found their passion going to a center drawing or wherever. So I think it's really necessary to discover our passions and have the space where to do it. So I have some questions that would be on the practical side of the project. So I'm quite sure it will be easy for you to answer. So if the youth center would complement formal education, then there should be a coordination between both the formal and the informal. So youngsters will need time to go to the youth center, and for that they need to have less homework homework from school. So maybe you could introduce this idea on how to coordinate both systems. That's the first question. I have two more. also, do you want it to be focused on specific topics, for example, art activities? I say that because if we want for the youth center to offer all kinds of activities from all educational fields, maybe it's not going to be very feasible because we will need many teachers, many educators, and a very big building to be capable to have the chance to put all these people inside. But if you focus on a specific fields that maybe are not that related to the formal education, maybe you will arrive to a smaller number of youngsters, but your project will be more feasible and more effective. And the last question is how you think on attracting the youngsters, because I guess it will be not mandatory to go to the youth center. Then you will need a very strong campaign to attract young people for them to come to the center. And maybe after school, in the leisure time, they do not want to go to like another school to keep learning. So the way you want to communicate will be very important, because you need to do it to motivate them and sell it as a thing that there you will find your passion, you know? And how do you think you are going to deal with all of these questions?
Yes, thank you for your questions. I would start with the last one. Yes, of course, we will need a very strong communication strategy. The leadership of these youth centers would emphasize very, very harshly that this is not a school, which, yes, of course, the youngsters I would think that, oh, that's another school, but we have to make them believe that it will be for their advantage and for their benefit, and regarding to have focusing to specific topics, the basic idea was that anyone who participates in these activities or involved in the institution could propose some activities which they would like to do or which students could decide what they could do, and for that demand the leadership of the center could search for a professionalist or a teacher or anyone else who is capable of leading these activities. That was our basic idea, but this is also a good addition that some institutions could be specialized in some topics. For example, we can say that in a city there are three or four centers, and each center is specialized in one topic, and the other is specialized in this topic. So yes, I can also imagine that ID as well. And for the coordination between schools and youth centers, yes, this question is unique for every city and for every town, because of the distances, for example, and the transportation possibilities. But yes, you are right that coordination between schools and centers is needed because of the time schedules and the organizing the transport or perhaps I can imagine that the activity during the activities they could use the sport facilities of the school, so or other facilities of the school. Yes, we think that this coordination scheme wouldn't be so centralized. It would depend on the local leaders of the centers and the school. So yes.
Well, thank you guys for that discussion. If it's okay with you, I want to ask also Shia if she wants to add something to what we've been discussing, or else you can ask any other questions that you have, Shia.
I wanted to answer some questions, but I was like taking the time. I think it's very important to talk with schools and to be in constantly communication with them. And if we can take part in some way during the school, some specific hours or something, but it's hard to to introduce ourselves into the educational system because it's very different between all the European countries. Even in Spain, it's different from one community to another. So we know that it's quite difficult. And the idea is also to offer youth a place where they can share time and not only be in the street. Allow them to be together, to share the space, the time with people from different ages also, and prepare them to be active. If they want to do something, they want to prepare an activity, motivate them to do a class, so then you will have also active adults. I think for me that's the most important part in the project, to educate us as active citizens. And that could be it. Thanks.
Thank you, Shia. Alicia, do you want to say anything back in response to these comments?
I completely share their thoughts. I mean, I think that the best way to learn is learning from each other. sharing thoughts, and I think that this project could help to do it. So that's why I wanted in the beginning to congratulate you for this project, and I hope it will be successful and that will help our youth to get out home and to stand together and to share thoughts on different topics and be more how to say it, revolutionary. And when we want something, I mean, you know, for example, with the ecological part, we get it. I mean, we were the youth that were on the streets and we were together and we convinced our politicians to put it in the top of our priorities. So let's do it with many other things that we think that are our priorities, and let's work together and let's stay together. And also from the cultural part, I mean, if we want to share other things, other debates, other, I mean, not everybody needs to be revolutionary, but yes, I think it's really necessary that we stop being that much time in front of the computers and mobile phones, and we start to relationate between each other in person.
Thank you, Alicia. Sadly, we're running out of time and we have to close this session soon. But before we go, we tend to ask this question. We always ask this question to our guests. Can you leave us with a message, somehow inspirational message that can motivate the young people in watching and listening to take action and inspiring them in general before we go?
Well, I mean, inspirational message. I think that if you really want to do something, and you need to try it. If you don't try it, if you stay at home, for sure, you will not get it, never. And you need to talk to people and convince them, explaining the reasons that convinced you to get this issue. So I think that the most important part is to talk to each other, talk a lot, make it in person, because sometimes, you know, doing it by social media sometimes can make confusions. So do it in person. And if you really want to achieve something, you go for it. Go for it, convince people, and for sure you will get it. I mean, we have many, many, many examples around the history that where it happened. And I think that that's the most important thing, that to convince, to talk a lot and to do it. Don't think that it's impossible. Nothing is impossible.
Thank you so much, Alicia. Well, this is all we have time for today now, for reals. Thank you so much, Alicia, again, for being here, taking the time to share this moment with us and look into the presentation that Dinesh and Lucia proposed. Thank you so much. Thank you, guys, Dinesh and Lucia, for being here on screen with us. And thank you to everyone that's been watching from Facebook. Thank you to the Youth for Europe team, as always, for organizing this beautiful project and this online series in difficult times. And yeah, stay tuned. We have a few conferences left, but there's still some. They're always good. Go on the website, youthforeurope.eu or Facebook page, and you can watch them there. And yeah, I hope to see you all in Brussels later on in the year. Goodbye.